look at the shift away from a national economy to a global economy. The concept of a world community has been with us for years, so it's no surprise that Coca-Cola, the number one world brand, captured the dream and sent it around the world.
I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honeybees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Sing with me.
Perfect harmony.
Perfect harmony.
I'd like to buy the world a Coke and keep it company.
The global economic village is more than just trade among 180 countries. The world is becoming a single unitary global economy. The jet airplane and communication satellite brought the world closer together. The jet airplane made transcontinental meetings an everyday occurrence. The communication satellite collapsed the information float, which is the time it takes for information to travel from one place to another. Now we are all active players in the world market because for the first time we can all share information simultaneously. Walter Wriston, former CEO of the world's largest bank, Citicorp, recognized the importance of this early in the information age.
We operate today in a global marketplace. And the streams of electrons that are going around the world today have created a true revolution. And I would remind you that the bloodiest battle of the War of 1812 was fought almost a month after the peace treaty was signed in England because the sailing ship couldn't get here in time and thousands of people died. Today, if the President of the United States holds a news conference, it shows up in the cross rate on the dollar sterling market in London in less than 60 seconds, so that the front page of the Wall Street Journal is printed by bouncing electrons off a satellite, and so is our general ledger, and so is the computer switch in Bahrain or Hong Kong or London. So we have tied together a database in the world which is capable of telling anybody anywhere in the world almost anything immediately.
With the third world now becoming enfranchised in the global market, the world is in the process of a redistribution of labor and production, a resorting out of who's going to make what. Natural resources and low-cost labor make the third world the ideal candidate for the task of manufacturing, and the developed world is taking up new roles in the information economy. In the 50s, the United States made about 80% of the world's cars. By the 1980s, our share had gone down to about 25%. The new industrial champion is Japan, but that's a little like a new champion in a declining sport. The challenge for developed nations today is to let go of the old industrial era and embrace the opportunities of the new information economy. Businesses that depend entirely on heavy industry would do well to diversify, and not just in the electronic sector. Biology, for example, is replacing physics as the growth area in science. Gene splicing will become more important than atom splitting. As microelectronics has dominated the last half of the 20th century, biology will prevail in the 21st century. We can now look for tremendous opportunity in alternative energy sources, financial services, and of course, the computer and all associated services. It is especially critical that the developed countries forge a new relationship with the third world. America will gradually relinquish the role of the world's dominant economic and political force. no country will dominate in the global economy. Only by developing the third world will we be assured of markets for our goods. In an interdependent world, aid is not charity, it is investment. The more economically interdependent we become, the more we will do the human thing. If we are sufficiently interlaced economically, it is likely that we will not bomb each other off the face of the planet. We should welcome increased trade with the Soviet Union, all developed nations, and the Third World. In fact, it is a real possibility that the path to world peace lies through world trade.